My name is Gary Smulyan, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce two NEA jazz masters, Phil Woods and Jimmy Heath. Phil and Jimmy, welcome. Great to see you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Good to be
great
here.
To talk to you. Two of my biggest heroes. Would you mind talking a little bit about your respective starts, Phil, you in Springfield, Massachusetts, and Jimmy, you in Philadelphia? You know, when we think of Springfield, it's not really, we don't consider, you know, we think of it as a real hotbed of jazz, but there was definitely a scene going on.
Frankie Carl comes from Springfield.
Frankie Carl?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And?
Dizzy Gillespie's mother.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, but also Sal Salvador and
Sal Salvador,
Joe Morello.
Joe Morello.
Right.
Chuck Andrews was mm-hmm. bass player with the Woody's band. Hal Serra, a piano player that I grew up with, was a music director for Julie London.
Right. And Springfield Rifles?
Springfield Rifles. Well, we were called that after, but we were just kids together.
Yeah. And you also played with Carmen Rebosa. These aren't household names, but these had some...
Carmen Rebosa and his rhythm heirs. We used to rehearse in the living room, you know, and all the Italians would be on the couch watching us play. And my father used to call Carmen Rebosa and his rhythm heirs. And my father said, you should call it Carmen Rebosa and his riveters, because it's bloody awful. You know? It was, you know.
Yeah.
Sounded like a fire in a pet shop. But music was a pretty good. Wendell Bradway had a territory band, Mal Hallett's band was from Springfield, Ray Borden from Boston. Massachusetts, it's still a pretty
well, I was state. Actually surprised to see, you know, the kind of the breadth of the scene when, you know, coming up when you did. I didn't realize that there was such a scene. So it was real, you had a lot of, it was a good place for you to be when you were growing up.
It was, but I left when I was 15,
you
know, as soon as I heard about Charlie Parker, I was out of there. And said, did you go to Boston? I said, no, I went to New York, baby.
Yeah.
To the Apple immediately, yeah.
Of course. And Jimmy, what about yourself growing up in Philly in terms of, you know, when you first started
career didn't start in Philly. I was actually in Wilmington, North Carolina, when my father sent me the saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
I used to go to Wilmington in the winter to a high school and go back to Philly, which was my home, in the summertime, and take some saxophone lessons from a gentleman there that was in the mold of Johnny Hodges and Benny Carter.
Cool.
Professor Terry, mm-hmm. his name was, and I studied alto with him mm-hmm. because alto was my first instrument.
Right.
But Philadelphia had a good musical scene, but I started in the fall when I was in high school playing with the, you know, marching band and stuff like that, and playing Washington Post and all of those kind of mm-hmm. compositions on Wisconsin and all of the colleges I couldn't attend. I would be playing their songs because my father didn't have money to send me to those schools. And they may not have accepted me anyway. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about in an era when racism was rampant. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the school I went to in Wilmington, North Carolina, Williston Industrial High School, only went to the 11th grade. That was the state of North Carolina's law. Train and I finished the same high school in 1943. He was in High Point, North Carolina. I was in Wilmington. We didn't know each other, but we both suffered the same indignities of finishing in the 11th grade, cap, gown, the whole works, but no algebra, geometry, and don't think about trigonometry or any of that. So I was a victim of the racism at that time.
Wow. Well, besides John Coltrane, who we knew you grew up with and spent a lot of time with, who else was on the scene back in Philly when you were growing up?
Well, no, Train did not grow up in Philly.
Well, he was in High Point, but at some
point...
Yeah,
but no, he came out of the Navy mm-hmm. to Philadelphia. There was already a lot of people around Philadelphia that could play before Train got there. Bill Barron,
right.
Kenny Barron's older brother, was a good saxophonist. And there were others, a saxophonist by the name of Jimmy Oliver, who actually played better than Benny Golson, Train, and myself at that time, but he never got a reputation because he couldn't read.
Right. So who would you say, as a young saxophonist, budding saxophonist coming up, did you have a particular mentor or a particular teacher that really meant, you know, a lot to you and kind of sent you out on your path, on your way? I know you've spoken about Harvey LaRose.
Harvey LaRose
many
was,
times.
That was the magic, I think. And when you find one teacher that turns you around, you know, because I was just faking it. I found the saxophone and I was thinking about melting it down and making toy soldiers. That was my thrust of life at 12 years old.
And where did that horn come from?
I found it under my grandmother's wicker sofa, you know, in the 40s. Opened it up and it was all shiny and stuff. And I said to myself, ooh, man, I melt this sucker down. I can make some toy soldiers and be a killer, you know. And somebody mistook this avaricious intent for an interest in music. So my mother, after a couple of weeks, she said, well, Philip, you know, your uncle went to a great deal of trouble to leave you the saxophone. And even at age 12, I realized that dying could be construed as a great deal of trouble. You know, that's why I'm going to save it for last, actually, you know.
Yeah.
And so I got the Yellow Pages and I called Harvey LaRose Drum Shop. And I made an appointment for a lesson. And to show you what a natural I was, I said, should I bring the saxophone?
Right.
And I heard this, you know, oh my God, you know, what have I got here? But my life changed with that, because I went and learned the root bank and the basic stuff. And then I went home and put the horn in the closet and made Mom happy. But I went back the next week and I could play the lesson.
What was he having you work on? Was he teaching you standards and harmony? Was
no, not doing, in the beginning.
Nothing
no, I'm
like
talking
that.
About the, from the get-go.
Very beginning,
I mean,
yeah.
I was not interested at all.
Mm-hmm.
I was not interested in playing music, you know. But he discovered that I had a good tone. Mm-hmm. I could always make a nice sound.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a fast student without even half trying. I mean, if he'd have been a more straight-laced music teacher, he might have said, like, how dare you? You know, you're using your ear to play music, you know, which is only our best friend, you
right.
know, the ear. If you can hear it, you can have it. If you can't hear it, you ain't gonna get it, you know. And he recognized that. So within a very short period, I was playing the pop tunes of the week, the hit parade, you know. And then Mr. LaRose would play the piano and show me the chords. And he urged me to improvise a bit. He'd say, decorate. You don't have to play what's written. Mm-hmm. I mean, imagine, you know.
Right, trying to get you to be creative.
So, yeah. So. I fell in love with, and I started to practice 26 hours a day. I mean, I just,
right.
and only because of the teacher.
Well, that's pretty inspiring.
Yep.
I remember reading about you running around, walking around your kitchen table doing laps practicing.
Yeah, I would do 50 laps of long tones and 50 laps of scales or whatever, yeah.
50 laps around your dining room table.
Yep.
That's a good concept.
It's
maybe
a
we
big
get
table.
Some,
it's
some
a
of
big
our
table
own students
too.
To do that, right?
It's a way of marking time and something
right.
to do. And when I got a gig in a marching band, I was really good.
Did anybody look at you like you were completely out of your mind?
Marched my buns off, man.
Did anybody wonder, what is this kid doing?
He's yeah, a lot of people still wonder about yeah. that.
Well, I don't know about that. What about you, Jimmy?
Well, you know, when my father sent me the saxophone, the first thing I did as a curious kid was to take some of the keys off.
Uh-oh.
And I took the three side keys off and I laid them down. But I was smart enough to know not to take them all off.
Mm-hmm.
I took them off and put it back on. See, and that's the last time I took a saxophone apart. I let somebody else do that now. But the songs I was taught by Mr. Terry were songs, they were sort of popular songs of the day. I remember he taught me a song, Maria Elena. You know, and Amapola.
My pretty little poppy.
You know, the songs like that. And you know, I was always interested in Johnny Hodges and Benny Carter. So I was checking out Friends. Who are like, we all were coming up together and we would exchange ideas. So at the same time I was taking the lessons, I was learning probably more from my friends about improvising.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, and that began. Then I got really curious later and started studying what's in the music, and more from a, I think I had to have a really a way of being a divided person in that I love writing music as much as I do playing it. Mm-hmm. And I'm a divided personality in that way. If I could write a song that was important to me, then, you know, like when you stand up and play a solo and everybody claps, it's like sometimes it's routine. They just know that, oh, he stopped. So they clap. But I mean, when you write some music and somebody else records it that you admire, then you feel like you've done something in life to have some of your peers to record your music.
Right.
So I've been in that mold all my life.
Well, the both of you have certainly written some incredible music through the years and continue to do so.